JBN, we keep you informed. I am Michelle Jones, and in the news, woman fatally shot, man injured in Linstead. A woman died on Sunday in a gun attack at Banbury District in Linstead, St. Catherine. She's Natalie Kelly Baker, a 40-year-old nursing aide. A man who was also shot in the incident is said to be in serious condition in hospital. Reports are that about 7:15 p.m., Baker was outside a shop when two armed men approached her and a friend. They opened gunfire on both before fleeing in nearby bushes. Baker, who returned to the island from Britain recently, was pronounced dead at hospital. She's at least the second woman shot in Linstead this month. In the previous incident, which took place on October 12, a gunman shot and wounded a woman on Grove Road while she was walking from her home to work. She has been admitted to hospital in critical but stable condition. Social worker charged with sexual offence involving minor. A social worker attached to the Ministry of Justice's Victim Support Unit in Port Maria St. Mary has been charged with a sexual offence involving a minor. The police gave his name as Lincoln Dennis of Monique in St. Anne. He has been charged with having sexual intercourse with a minor and misconduct in a public office. The incident allegedly took place in March this year, and the accused was subsequently charged after investigations were carried out. Dennis appeared before the Port Maria Parish Court last week Thursday, where he was remanded. He is to reappear in court on Wednesday, October 27. Businessman becomes 24th murder victim in St. Thomas. The St. Thomas police have commenced investigations into Monday night's shooting of a man at his business place in the Whitehall area of the parish. That is Warren Williams, a businessman of Whitehall in the parish. Reports are that at about 8:30 p.m., Williams was at his establishment close to his home when he was pounced upon by a man armed with a gun who opened gunfire, hitting him. The culprit reportedly fled the area. Williams was taken to the hospital where he was pronounced dead. St. Thomas has recorded 24 murders so far this year. This is one more than the 23 homicides recorded in the Southeast Parish for the entire period last year. Policeman found guilty of abduction and rape. A police constable who was charged with the 2012 abduction and rape of a woman in St. Thomas was found guilty of the offences when he appeared in the St. Thomas Circuit Court on Monday. Constable Craig Williams was also found guilty of illegal possession of a firearm. He'll be sentenced on November 15. The constable had pleaded not guilty to all counts. However, evidence was heard from the woman, three witnesses and two police officers on October 20 when the Crown closed its case. The judge on Monday gave his summation and a guilty verdict was returned on all counts of the indictment. Lawsuit threat for crash negligence. The legal team representing the estate of Kevin O. Smith has warned that a civil suit might be filed against the state arising from Monday's death of the controversial pastor. Queen's Counsel Varunita Robertson, who was representing Smith, disclosed that the family of the deceased will make a decision soon on the matter. Nita Robertson said that she was retained by Smith's sister to represent him and will be advising the family on the prospects of proceeding with the suit, which will center on allegations of state negligence in the transportation of her now deceased client. "They have breached all courtesies to counsel and the ethics of the profession," Nita Robertson said in describing the actions of some police officers. Smith died in a motor vehicle crash while being transported from Montego Bay to Kingston to be charged with murder and other offenses. Constable Orlando Irons, who was assigned to the Montego Bay Fugitive Apprehension Team, also died in the accident, which occurred near the Linstead Bypass in St. Catherine. Smith and dozens of congregants were detained 2 Sundays ago after two people were killed in a bizarre ritual at the Pathways International Kingdom Restoration Ministries Church in Montego Bay. A third person who allegedly attacked the police was also shot dead. Nita Robertson disclosed that attorney-at-law Henry McCurdy was set to appear with her in the case. On Monday, McCurdy was to represent Smith in an application for a writ of habeas corpus in the St. James Parish Court. Smith was seeking his immediate release from custody or to be charged and placed before the court where he could apply for bail. Nita Robertson said that when she and McCurdy tried to locate Smith, who was being detained at the Barnett Street Police lockup in Montego Bay, they were unable to get any information from the police on his whereabouts. "This cloak and dagger behavior by the police is despicable," Nita Robertson added. She said it was later in the morning that someone sent her a video of the fatal crash. Last week, applications for writs of habeas corpus were made on behalf of the other detainees, and Nita Robertson said the parish judge had ordered that they be released if they were not charged by Wednesday. Nita Robertson lamented that the police did not travel on the toll highway with her client. She questioned whether the police were trying to avoid paying $1,600 in toll fees. Senior Superintendent Stephanie Lindsay, head of the police information arm, said that she was unaware of the reason the cops did not travel on the highway. The last time Nita Robertson saw her client was on Saturday. The Queen's Counsel said that Smith could hardly walk and complained that his feet were hurting. He asked to be taken to the doctor, but Nita Robertson said his request was denied. Nita Robertson said her client could have been charged in St. James, where the alleged offense took place, before being transferred to the Home Circuit Court in Kingston. Andrew's Memorial Hospital donates computers to St. Andrew Technical High School. St. Andrew Technical High School has received 10 laptop computers, valued at approximately $600,000, from the Andrews Memorial Hospital in St. Andrew. The presentation was made to the school's principal, Dr. Worrell Hibbert, by President and the CEO of the hospital, Dr. Patrick Rutherford, along with Vice President of Finance, Don Main Giles, and Marketing and Public Relations Officer, Herman Wade, who visited the school recently. In making the presentation, Dr. Rutherford said the hospital had been blessed with the donation of 100 computers from Advent Health, a Seventh-day Adventist institution. These are ideal for students who are learning online. We gave some to members of our staff for their children. We also donated to other schools. But we felt that a school, especially one in the inner city, would benefit from this gift. I also have a special place in my heart for this school because St. Andrew Technical was a school that helped me with the research for my doctoral dissertation. I made sure to reserve 10 so that the children here can benefit, Rutherford said. Hibbert said that while the gift came as a surprise, it was greatly appreciated, particularly at this time when there are so many challenges and uncertainties brought about by the COVID-19 pandemic. This is also a very timely gift, as our school is celebrating its 60th anniversary this year. The computers will be a tremendous benefit to our students, and we are very grateful. Interest groups call for urgent reopening of schools. Several organizations have issued an open letter calling for the government to urgently reopen schools to face-to-face teaching and to share plans for learning loss recovery and more resilience in the education sector as COVID-19 continues. The letter is co-signed by the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF, National Parent Teachers Association of Jamaica, Jamaica Association of Principals of Secondary Schools, Jamaica Youth Advocacy Network, Jamaica Chamber of Commerce, Jamaica Manufacturers and Exporters Association, Jamaica Employers Federation, and the Business Process Industry Association of Jamaica. The group argues that Jamaica's children have lost an estimated 1.3 billion in-class hours over 19 months of physical school closures. It is further being argued that the learning loss is staggering, with the most vulnerable children who struggle to access remote education have been hit the hardest. The education of our children cannot be delayed anymore. As we face the biggest education crisis of our history, we must consider the cost of our inaction. That price is too high for our children to pay. The cost will continue to affect Jamaica's development prospects for generations. We have no more time to lose, the group asserted. Against that background, the organization said the government should move to urgently have the safe reopening of schools to face-to-face teaching and to remove any barriers that stand in the way, including vaccination targets for schools. All our children, especially the most disadvantaged, deserve more focused attention and better learning opportunities than remote education can offer. This is critical for their development, safety, and well-being. Schools can be fully and safely reopened. This has been done elsewhere, and we can do it too. The group is also calling for the government to articulate effective and evidence-based strategies and implementation plans to ensure that the education system delivers a comprehensive recovery response. Effective remedial learning, psychosocial interventions, targeted and relevant social safety net provisions, and ongoing support for teachers to address the needs of the children should be central to these efforts, the organizations charged. Further, the group wants the government to put in place the policies and resources necessary to make the country's education system more resilient. Our education system needs to be prepared for emerging and dynamic threats, and we must work across sectors to achieve resilience. Plans for risk mitigation and disaster risk management and response must be relevant, flexible, and scalable. They also need to be adequately funded. 49 new COVID-19 cases, one death recorded in Jamaica. Jamaica recorded 49 new cases of COVID-19 and one virus-related death on Monday, pushing the total number of confirmed cases on the island since the outbreak to 88,480 and the confirmed deaths to 2,184. The new cases comprise 34 females and 15 males, with ages ranging from 10 months to 89 years. According to the Ministry of Health and Wellness, 12 of the cases were recorded in Kingston and St. Andrew, 10 in St. Catherine, 9 in Clarendon, 5 each in St. James and Trelawney, 3 in St. Thomas, 2 each in Manchester and Westmoreland, and 1 in Hanover. Meanwhile, the latest victim is the 78-year-old male from Manchester. 2 more deaths were reported as coincidental. The ministry further reported 183 new recoveries, increasing the tally to 56,944. There are 28,751 confirmed active cases on the island. JBN, we keep you informed. Please remember to subscribe, like, share, leave us a comment, and click the notification bell to receive our daily news items.